Everybody, welcome back to a little tea time. Drinking a little tea out of one of my favorite mugs. All right, it's really early in the morning. I thought maybe I could do this without the dogs stirring and all around me and the cats walking by, although one has spotted me. So if you hear some meows, it's because it's food time, and I'll just edit some of that out. Anyway, I know yesterday's video might have gotten you pretty excited because you want to know more about maybe the Enlightenment or what happens next. I know I get pretty stoked about the Enlightenment. So let's look at the impact of the Enlightenment. So if you've got your review book, and I hope you do, I hope you can grab it and look at page 53. Get your review book. Okay, so on page 53, they break down, they go into Enlightened Despots. Now, despots is just a ridiculous word for king or queen. All right, don't sweat it. Don't worry about it. You don't really need to remember. Just notice when you see Enlightened Despots and they start listing kings and queens like the ones I'm about to list, they're talking about kings and queens. So one of the Enlightened Despots is King Frederick the Great. Another one, Joseph II. Then Catherine the Great. You'll notice that a lot of them Enlightened Despots, Enlightened Kings and Queens, have the title Great. They don't usually give themselves the title. Like Ivan the Terrible didn't walk around going, oh, I hope everybody calls me Ivan the Terrible. All right, if you're named Catherine the Great, that's usually from the people. So the people really like Catherine. They thought Catherine was doing a lot of great things. Get it? Catherine's doing a lot of great things. So let's go into this. All right, so your book's open. You ready to go? Let's do this. Some monarchs accepted Enlightenment ideas. They were known as Enlightened Despots, absolute rulers who used their power to reform society. Now, Frederick the Great, King of Prussia, Frederick II saw himself as the first servant of the state with a duty to work for the common good, a follower of Voltaire. Remember, tear it up, Voltaire. He wanted to tear up all the old things and make new things better, religious freedom, things like that. Remember, Voltaire, tear it up. All right, he tolerated different religions, reduced the use of torture, and allowed a free press. But in the end, his reforms increased his own power. All right, part of it's because of popularity. Now, Joseph II, the Holy Roman Emperor, Joseph II, continued and expanded many of his mother, Maria Theresa's, reforms, such as taxing the nobility and making primary education available to all children. So here we've got two monarchs from two different areas. All right, Frederick the Great is from Prussia. Joseph II, and doesn't say it in here, but he's Austrian. Oh, it gets to it, but he's Austrian. So we've got two different monarchs from Central Europe, essentially, who are saying, yes, let's expand rights, let's help people, let's increase education and religious toleration. Now, Maria Theresa's, the most radical of the Enlightened Despots, Joseph, modernized the Austrian government, chose officials for their talents rather than their status, and implemented legal reforms. He also practiced religious toleration, ended censorship, and abolished serfdom. However, many of Joseph's reforms were later overturned. So you just saw an image. That's Catherine the Great. She's my favorite of all these Enlightened Despots, and one that most tests, if you ever take any sort of test like a regents or whatnot, will focus on in some way. Now, Catherine the Great, I'm going to read right out of your book for you. So in Catherine the Great in 1762, all right, Catherine II, later known as Catherine the Great, became Empress of Russia. During her reign, she read Enlightenment works and even corresponded with Voltaire, tear it up, and Montesquieu. Three branches. All right, so as a result of her exposure to the Enlightenment ideas, Catherine asked for the advice of nobles, free peasants, and townspeople. Never before had Russian citizens been allowed to advise the government. All right, Catherine also built schools, hospitals, promoted the education of women, and granted some religious tolerance. But, like Frederick the Great, she did not give up power. Unfortunately, many of Catherine's reforms were short-lived. Later in her reign, Catherine grew more repressive after a peasant uprising. Okay, she treated the peasants like they were little kids. Now, Catherine the Great is a really interesting character in history because her reign was so long, but she influenced so many different people. Now, part of this whole time period was that liberty starts to become a rally cry for a lot of people. And as these enlightened despots start to try to manage these populations that are becoming more educated, that are starting to question how their government works, what you start to find out is people want more liberty. Now, this is going to lead us to a little thing called the French Revolution. Now, the French Revolution is really the next phase of the Enlightenment. Now, they were influenced by England's Glorious Revolution in 1689. All right, that's the one, you might remember it from your studies, all right, where William and Mary take the throne. There's a famous college in the South called William and Mary, all right, so you can definitely find that and check that out. And you've got the American Revolution, which, remember, when was the Declaration of Independence? That's right, 1776, July 4th, if you went that far. So that whole time, like, they're really well influenced, the French, and they're seeing what's happening to with other monarchies in Europe. But the one thing that's really happening in France is their own monarch, Louis the 16th. And now remember, France is like the birthplace in the Enlightenment. Now, John Locke, he's British, yeah, we all know that, but so many of the Enlightenment thinkers come from France. So France is fertile, man. They want a revolution. They want change, and they're not willing to wait for it. And their monarch, Louis the 16th, was so slow to move to any change at all. He wanted to continue to have these lavish parties where people came to see him from all over the world. All right, people like that you might be familiar with, like Ben Franklin used to go to these parties, and they were lavish, and he spent lots of money, and then he'd have just extravagant festivals for the nobility, and eventually the taxpayers are like, we don't want to pay that anymore. Just look at page 54 if you've got a review book, or if you don't, you just want to listen, I'm going to read a little section of it to you. I'm going to look at where the revolution follows a typical pattern. The French Revolution followed a pattern common to many political revolutions. In this pattern, revolutions pass through different stages caused by changes in leadership and shifts in power. Problems began to appear in a country, and revolutionary groups form, hoping to correct the injustices. At the beginning of the revolution, moderate reformers come to power. As their compromised reforms fail, power passes to more radical groups. All right? And the more radical revolutionaries are, in the French Revolution, known as the Jacobins. All right, you might remember the Jacobins from previous studies. Now, the revolution grows more violent and extreme. A reaction to the violence follows, bringing moderates back to power. Often at that point, there is a return to the old order as people turn to a leader who promises order along with reform. Oh, the French Revolution is so typical to, like, even your relationships in life, okay? Like, you know, suddenly you get in a fight with a friend, it becomes like real radical, you start name calling and saying things you'd never say, and then calmer times where you start to go into moderation and you slide right back into the reasons you hated that relationship in the first place. That's the French Revolution, okay? So the cause of the French Revolution, absolute monarchy. All right, France had an absolute monarchy ruled by Louis the 16th, and he had spent so much money that France was broke. All right, there was social inequality. Since the Middle Ages, France had belonged to established three social classes, the three estates, the clergy, the first estate, the nobility, and the second estate. Those two estates held enormous amounts of wealth. And then the third estate, made up mostly of the bourgeois, which is the peasantry, they had very little wealth, all right, but were the largest group. It's that whole thing that you've heard before, taxation without representation. It does not work. It did not work here in America. It does not work in France. It does not work. Now, the French Revolution in general, these early stages are a real confluence of some terrible things. So you've got a king who's spending too much money. You've got what is actually known as like the Little Ice Age occurs. This time period in history in the late 1700s where crops didn't grow real well. The summers were unusually cool for a couple of years. So you've got those things that start to happen. So grain prices go up. People didn't have money. They couldn't adjust to the inflation. Listen, folks, it's almost always about the environment and the economy. Those two things are what makes the world move. Okay, and if the environment and the economy suffer, social classes then get angry. If the social classes get angry, we are fertile for revolution. There's lots of trouble. So I want you to just think about that as we move through this. That's the beginning of the French Revolution. So stay tuned for part two of the revolution. Yo, VIP.